Hello guests, we will start in 5 minutes while everyone gets connected.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the embassies of Guatemala and the Republic of Indonesia and in the Kingdom of Thailand, we welcome all of you to this virtual conference on commemorate the 199 year of independence of the Republic of Guatemala. My name is Victor Ramirez Escaglia. I am the Deputy of Mission from the Embassy of Guatemala in Indonesia, and I will share this hosting with my colleagues, Celeste Marinelli, Deputy of Mission from the Embassy of Thailand. To start, we will play the national anthem on the Republic of Indonesia, and following the greeting from by Minister of Foreign Affairs of Guatemala, Ambassador Atsung Arevalo de Moscoso, to Guatemalan community. And then the messages from their excellencies, Ambassador of Guatemala to Indonesia and to Thailand. Video.
Queridos guatemaltecos residentes en Indonesia y Tailandia, para mí es un gusto extenderles un cálido y cordial saludo en nombre del doctor Alejandro Yamatei Faya, presidente de la República de Guatemala, y del embajador Pedro Brolo Vila, ministro de Relaciones Exteriores. Guatemala, siendo un país pluricultural, multiétnico y multilingüe, con un variado patrimonio cultural, material e inmaterial, destaca la importancia de la diplomacia cultural como un instrumento de desarrollo integral que busca unificar esfuerzos con otras naciones para la construcción de la paz y el fortalecimiento del respeto de los derechos culturales de nuestros pueblos a través del intercambio de vivencias de nuestro rico y variado patrimonio cultural. Bajo ese compromiso, el Ministerio de Relaciones Exteriores se encarga de reforzar los vínculos existentes entre instituciones nacionales y artistas guatemaltecos para implementar estrategias en materia de diplomacia cultural que enriquezcan a nuestra querida Guatemala. En el marco de las distintas actividades que se realizan para la conmemoración del 199 aniversario de independencia de la República de Guatemala, presentamos el webinar Cielos Mayas, un viaje cultural y científico por los cielos oscuros de Guatemala, que ha sido autoría del astrofotógrafo guatemalteco Sergio Montúfar. Hoy ustedes podrán apreciar esta actividad, los cielos nocturnos oscuros, revalorizar y sensibilizar temas como la conservación del patrimonio cultural y natural, nacional e internacionalmente, para promover las concepciones cosmológicas mayas de Guatemala al mundo Agradezco al astrofotógrafo Sergio Montúfar por su contribución científica y su activismo ambiental nocturno para fortalecer los conceptos culturales y naturales relacionados con la astronomía en varios países de Latinoamérica. Desde el Ministerio de Relaciones Exteriores, vamos a posicionar a Guatemala en el concierto de las naciones como un país de extraordinaria riqueza cultural y natural, conformado por nuestros pueblos mayas, garífunas, xinca y ladinos, herederos de una cultura milenaria con conocimientos y tradiciones ancestrales. Finalizo con el siguiente proverbio maya que dice: el que cree, crea, y el que crea, hace, y el que hace, se transforma a sí mismo y a la sociedad en la que vive. Felices fiestas patrias y que viva Guatemala. Muchas gracias.
Honorable authorities of the government of Indonesia, Your Excellencies, Head of the Diplomatic Missions, Guatemalan community residing in Indonesia, dear friends. On September 15, Guatemala and the nation of Central America will celebrate the 199th anniversary of their independence. Guatemala is located in Central America and has a great wealth in natural resources, tremendous tourism potential, a Maya culture which still is alive and will surprise you when you visit our countries. In addition, it has the largest economy in Central America, and its population is characterized by being very friendly and extremely hardworking. In order to strengthen ties of friendship, cooperation, and expand its international presence, Guatemala recently inaugurated its diplomatic mission in Indonesia. During these first 9 months, we have embarked an important work agenda in the economic, cultural, tourist, and academic areas. I am sure that this work will serve to open new doors and opportunity for both countries. This year, the celebration of our national day is carried out virtually. Guatemala and the rest of the world is fighting against the consequences of the COVID-19 pandemic. Unfortunately, life has been lost and the economic effects had a significant impact. But I am sure that our Creator will help us emerge stronger from this test. I want to thank all the friends of Guatemala in Indonesia for joining us in this conference called My Sky that will be dictated by astrophotographer Sergio Montúfar, whose greatest dream is to preserve the dark skies and encourage people to view the stars. Now, I would like to greet the Guatemalan community residing in Indonesia in Spanish. Compatriotas, este 15 de septiembre nuestro país estará celebrando su Día Nacional. En esta fecha especial recordemos con amor y respeto a nuestra Guatemala. Esta celebración será muy diferente. No tendremos desfiles cívicos ni recorridos de antorchas o bailes folclóricos, pero la patria siempre la llevamos en la sangre. Los exhorto para que con su hacer diario sigan enalteciendo a la tierra que los vio nacer y desde lejos todos demostremos que los guatemaltecos somos personas de bien. Es propicia esta fecha para recordar esta estrofa de nuestro himno nacional. Ojalá que remonte su vuelo más que el cóndor y el águila real y en sus alas levante hasta el cielo, Guatemala, tu nombre inmortal. Muchas gracias y que Dios los bendiga. Thank you. Terima kasih.
Distinguished authorities, excellencies, dear friends, as the Guatemalan ambassador to the Kingdom of Thailand, it is a great pleasure to welcome you to the presentation that we have prepared for our National Day this year. We had the expectation that we would meet personally, as it was the first time we celebrated our anniversary in the city of Bangkok. But we are in the middle of the pandemic due to the COVID-19 coronavirus that does not allow us to receive you at the traditional reception. Given this limitation, instead, we will commemorate the 199th anniversary of our independence with an online cultural event, and for that, we are pleased to introduce you to the Guatemalan astrophotographer, Sergio Montúfar, a distinguished artist with an international recognition who will offer us the virtual conference Ancestral Stars. Guatemala is a multicultural country, and we are proud of the ancient Maya culture, one of the cradles of civilization in the American continent that created a sophisticated society whose achievements in architecture, mathematics, and astronomy are part of our heritage. The artist Sergio Montúfar chose precisely the archaeological site of the Mayan culture to create his work of Dark Skies, which we will have the privilege of admiring on this occasion. I wish to emphasize that we are 1 year away from celebrating the bicentennial of our independence, which took place on September 15, 1821. Next year, we hope to hold an event where we can gather all together in the celebration of 200 years of Guatemalan independent life. I want to thank the authorities of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Guatemala for their support to carry out this event together with my colleague Jacobo Cuyun, the Guatemalan ambassador to the Republic of Indonesia. I want to thank as well the members of the Guatemalan embassy in Thailand for all the preparation made in a professional way. And a special appreciation to the astrophotographer Sergio Montúfar for the presentation of his work, Ancestral Stars. Thank you all very much for your interest and your virtual presence in this opportunity. Let's enjoy it.
Dear guests, now we will proceed to the much anticipated conference. As you were able to read in his biography when we sent the invitation, Sergio has exhibited his photographs in various countries all over the world. He is also an active advocate of the conservation of dark skies and has given several conferences on astrophotography. He has also collaborated actively with the Planetarium of La Plata in Argentina. His presentation will last approximately 20 to 30 minutes, and after that, there will be time for questions and answers. We invite you to write your questions on the text box of Q&A throughout his conference, and afterwards, we will give him the floor again, and we will be reading the questions after the presentation. So, Sergio, you have the floor now.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you for this great opportunity to share this experience, life experience, with the people of Thailand and Indonesia, and also the Guatemala community in those countries. I want to thank the Vice Minister of Exterior Foreigns and also the ambassadors of both countries, and also to you guys for this great development of this event. So to start, I am going to share with you a video, and I'm going to, I hope you like this presentation. So astrophotography is a scientific tool developed by the knowledge and practice of many disciplines. The main goal is to gather an amount of light and process it to understand our cosmos. This light gathering and processing techniques became a pillar of science, inspiring new ideas and technologies. It's also the evidence of the power of many brains working together for the benefit of society. In astrophotography, there is a thin boundary between science and art, which makes the technique even more important for its influence in culture. The outcome becomes a great inspirational and educational tool like any other, that allows the viewer to be transported into the unseen. When the artistic process is finished, the outcome breaks the boundary of the impressive, and to most observers, inspires dreams and curiosity. It tells the stories of galaxies, nebulas, solar systems, and nowadays it tells the stories of cultural and natural astronomical landmarks. This is art and science merged together into visual poetry. From the different astrophotography expressions, my favorite is landscape astrophotography. This technique was born after the curious wildfield astrophotographers decided to experiment by including the landscape in their astronomical wildfield images. Those astrophotographers who started testing camera gears in low light conditions, exploring light at night, followed the logics behind astrophotography light gathering and processing techniques. And this became a different way of expression and science outreach. Landscape astrophotography opens channels to easily connect live view with the cosmos. It discovered nature and scales of wonders and the stories of our cultures that were greeting in the stars. Humans are battling against climate change, but there's another natural threat. By 2016, it was calculated that 80% of the world's population lived under light pollution sky. Unplanned clear lighting arrays are causing a growing natural disaster and a gap between human and nature, especially at night, at a grayscale and an alarming small period of time. Since we reached the moon, human population almost doubled. We also expanded our boundaries in communications with connectivity through computers, cell phones, but growing empty content in social media is causing another big gap within humans' space. We stop questioning ourselves, who we are, where do we go, and what surrounds us. Cold War took political leaders to get the man to the moon, but in great addition, it became one of the greatest achievements in human history, because it was the effort of many disciplines working together for the same goal. Though the Apollo program cost billions, but inspired millions have no cost. Out of space, the only way to witness Earth is in a lunar eclipse, when Earth's shadow is projected on the moon surface. That is Earth, that is our shadow. The moon had influence in cultures in centuries. Do you see that rabbit on the moon? Do you know about the Mayan worldview and what the rabbit means? We know that El Camino de Santiago is our Milky Way. It is known in Spain with the name because the pilgrims who marched to Santiago Compostela from Europe used the position of the Milky Way in the sky during summer as a reference to follow shipment and reach their destination. Now, what are we going to do? How are we going to drive people's eyes back to the sky? In Guatemala, we have great nature, we have great culture, and we want to inspire the world to look back to the stars. And we also want to teach the world about the greatest of our culture and our scientific basement that is still alive in our Mayan communities. So this is Guatemala through the eyes of the Ajikik. So I'm going to start sharing another presentation. So to start with, Pinceladas Nocturnas is a dark sky program which wants to teach people about dark sky conservation and also want to merge science and art together to inspire a new type of perception of our universe. The program is supported by UNESCO, Universidad del Valle, and International Dark Sky Association. In this map, we see light pollution of Guatemala, a country with 7 million in population. We still have some areas that are preserved, and they are the only areas preserved in Mesoamerica, which have great cultural advantage, and we can teach another type of preservation in our nature. So this is what we want to inspire the world. Light pollution is about bad lighting designs. In this graphic, we see a good lighting design and a terrible lighting design, and how it will change and it will impact the sky. Light pollution is important because it has a lot of impact, negative impact in our health. It has a lot of impact in ecosystems and also in economy. In this graphic, we see the different type of skies depending on a scale 1 to 9. Being a scale 1, an excellent dark sky. Scale 2, just a dark sky. Sky 3, roller sky. To the bottom scale 8 to 9, which is the city sky, which is most of the cities most of the cities in the world has this type of sky. And if you see, one of the greatest issues is the white light, because the white light increases brightness to the sky. So the suggested color temperature is 3000 degrees Kelvin below. And I want you guys to know this because it's important for your health and also for your economy. Astrophotography is a technique of light gathering technique and light processing techniques that will let us understand the cosmos. As I said before, it has a small boundary between art and science, which makes this technique special because it will inspire a lot of people to watch to the skies. This is the Orion Nebula, a very important nebula for Guatemala and Mayan worldview, because the Mayans in Guatemala believe that the world, the universe come from this nebula. And it's interesting because this is the greatest complex of newborn stars in our universe, closest to Earth. So in your Mayan worldviews, this is very important in the living communities, because they still represent this in their living days. So this is called deep sky astrophotography. There's another type of astrophotography, which is the planetary astrophotography. The technique is about a telescope, a mount, a camera, long exposures, integrating images. In this case, for planetary images, we use camera with videos. So we gather up much amount of videos and we process those videos, and we can get a lot of details from our planets. In this case, these are the moons taken in the National Observatory of La Plata. There's another type of astronomy, astrophotography, which is the wild field astrophotography. This astrophotography will let us understand the interaction between a lot of deep sky objects. In this case, this is the center of the Milky Way. But then, as I explained in the video before, the astrophotographer started integrating both. They started integrating landscape and they started integrating sky, creating this new or modern type of astrophotography, which was born around 1996 when the APOD started promoting this type of images. Then with the advantage that we have right now in technology, this technology is in the hands of many people that can create this type of images. And we have access to the internet, which will allow us to learn and to learn more about these techniques and learn about the concepts that we want to share. So in Guatemala, we start using the astrophotography as a landscape astrophotography, because we want to share to the world the knowledge of the Mayans and their worldview. So this is ancestral stars. This is the universe through the eyes of the Akik. So I'm going to start sharing with you guys this collection of images created thanks to the Ministry of Culture and also Mayan Akiks, who have shared with us their knowledge, and also scientists that have joined us to deliver great information. So I'm going to start getting these images and reading a little bit about it. So this is a representation of Nahuel Bats, and it says, "Behold the guardian of heaven who offers with sacred fire the point where heaven and earth touch each other. It is the beginning at the end, like a cosmic connection, a heart becoming a star. My destiny is the night where the stars shine." This is a sacred site called Nacimiento Río San Juan, Ahuacatán, Huehuetenango, Guatemala. Nahual E. I am like water and my only truth is the light. There, where a river is born, it's where I'm born. It's what I am. A strong stream of water as it travels in light ripples. It is my way, my destiny, and my sacred place, hidden by time, near the great volcano of San Pedro, right there, where it seems that Unahu made a goal. San Marcos La Laguna, Sololá, Guatemala. Nahual Aj, sacred land where the ancestor was invoked. By each side of the structure 12 at the altar dedicated to the birth of a child, as a symbol of renewal and through our way of acting. We are humans and we are all brothers. We are a family. The earth is our home. In our earth, we should show love. We sow space as Hunahpu and Isbalanque planted the seeds in the yard of the grandmother, Ishmugane. This is Structure 12, National Archaeological Park, Tacalica Baj, Retaluleu, Guatemala. Nahual X. It is a dark night with some jumping fishes and you can hardly see the stars. But if Ishbalanque, surrounded by a colored crown, paints an ode in honor to the Mayan altar. Let us commemorate the planet. Let's take care of our rivers, lakes, and our trees that are our older brothers. Sacred site, Laguna Lemoa. This is Quiche. The birth of colors, messenger of light, visits in the form of conjunction, the cosmic cross that was left in Inche, indicating us where the sacred corn is. Let the bad birds go, especially away from the sacred corn. This is Archaeological Park Isimche, Tecpan, Guatemala. We need balance in this chaotic universe. I remember my grandfathers and their advice. They told me not to repeat my mistakes. Let us always be in harmony with Mother Earth and known how to forgive. This is Altar 8, National Archaeological Park, Takalik Abaj. The purity of Mother Nature, far from light pollution. This evening of oil, Ixbalanque among a crown, painting the intense forest, a lungs of the planet, which is in danger. Amidst the dense fog that rises among trees, the trees or elder brothers in one of our views to the west of the enigmatic Temple 4 of Tikal National Park. Nahual Tijax, Tucurbalam is the place where the call is present. Tonight, the heart in the sky and the heart of earth play between drops of water suspended in the atmosphere. One of the ancestors in Structure 12, the Jaguar, which a man inside his mouth that is born with a knife in his hand, as well as Saturn at Tuantares. This is Monument 67, National Archaeological Site, Takalik Abaj. Nahual Cahuac, I am the night, and inside my heart, I carry a star that must shine. Cahuac, I bring you this offer for the good of sunrise. May the sick people find health, and may the world find peace. This is Monument E, Archaeological Park, Quiriguá, Izabal. It is the keen cut telu, carved by artists. How much art and how much history carved in the steel, steel age of Quiriguá. Tonight, I remember my path of on the face of earth in this blessed land. I want to be a better human for the well-being of my land and my brothers. This is Estelle H in Archaeological Park, Quiriguá. Nahual Imosh. I am like the water that was born in a sacred place where the river of purified water flows between the rocks. With my passion and my strength, I find no barriers. Keep alive the rivers. the wells, and the lagoons that are part of our Mother Earth. This is the Great Jaguar, Tikal National Park, Peting. It is the King Cat Teliu, carved by artists. How much art and how much history we find in our world. This is a nomadic style facing north in Tikal Archaeological, Takalikavak Archaeological Park. This is the monument called to the ancestors. Nahual Akkabal. Let's avoid sadness, slanders, and the lies. Let the new dawn begin. This is the sign that is clarifying. This is Temple 2, National Park of Tikal. Four cardinal points. To the east, the Pleiades and the planet Venus, where there was a sacred fire, tonight symbolize the energy, force, and heat that exists in our hearts. This is Archaeological Park Isinche. Over the horizon, the yellow color of the atmosphere, I found the line dividing earth and sky. The only connection between the heart of heaven and earth is Yakshe, which shows the cycle of time. How much time to pass? How many years of evolution for us to render a visual poem to the tree that has the roots to the underworld and its breaches to the divine world? Tonight in a sacred nine, this is Nahual Kang, in La Ceiba Archaeological Park, Quiriguá, Izabal. The passage of Hunahpu in the sky, first dressed with a crown and then with a halo. It is the passage of time over structure 12, the call of the ancestor. The serenity and joy in the hearts of the grandfathers. After having known the justice of the Khan on earth and exclaim, let us go to rest, to Kamen. I have done everything there, but the life of the children of our children and it being enduring. And this is Center of Spirituality and Medicine Maya Aukiche. This is Structure 12, Archaeological Park of Takalikavah, Nahual Kamen. Great Jaguar, the town's light leader. With a view towards one of the cardinal points, there where the sun and the stars are born, which are sustained by the force of the north, south, east, and west. This is the Great Jaguar National Park, Tikal. This is Nahual Kek. What a fantastic feeling of being alive, having consciousness to see and perceive where we are and what are we doing and where are we going. To feel nature, the plants, to see living beings, to see the stars and planets. This is Stel F, Archaeological Park of Quiriguá, Nahual Canil. I am the protector of the earth. I am the payment and balance of love and justice. I am the offer. This is Temple 4, Tikal National Park, Peteng. Nahual Toch. May we realize the damage we are doing to our Mother Nature, and that she, protector of the material and spiritual love, establish order and accuracy. This is the Central Plaza of Tikal National Park, Guatemala. Nahual Si. So this was the dark skies of Guatemala in sacred lands and archaeological parks. And these poems were dedicated through the eyes of the Akik. This was a representation of the Mayan calendar Cholkik, which you can search in the web to learn more about it. And this is basically my presentation. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much, Sergio. We will proceed now to the questions. So I think we can keep Sergio on the screen. And well, thank you very much for the presentation. The photographs and the video that you showed us are really impressive. We can see how art and science come together and learned about the importance of the conservation of the dark skies and its relevance for preserving cultural heritage as well. So we have several questions now. I will start with the first one. So is there a particular, we saw that what you explained us that it not everything, you cannot see everything perfectly with the dark skies and trying to aim at photography. Is there a particular shot for photograph that you would like to make someday that you still haven't done yet of capturing a specific dark sky?
Yes, I want to capture, thank you for the question. I want to capture the Milky Way in a really clear night inside Tikal Park. And I also want to capture a figure of Mayan Akik in smaller sizes than the moon. So I have to go 2 kilometers away and find the spot where the moon rises. And I want to have one of the Mayan Akik in the middle of the moon. And those are still two shots that I've been waiting for a lot of time to be able to do.
Thank you, Sergio. And how difficult is it to take the photographs, to get the sky that you want? Because you seem to have been able to have these shots in different Mayan heritage places. How difficult is it to get that shot in order to capture the sky that you want, knowing that there is so much light around us anymore and that you cannot have that clarity?
It will depend of the place that we are going to capture, right? In the case of the Mayan archaeological sites, there is a lot of authorization that have to be approved because there's no authorization or permissions to go inside. So that's why I have the support of the Ministry of Culture to be able to get to the site, get the pictures. I have a small period of time. And I also have to be lucky that I have the clear skies because most of the times I get to the place that I want to get a shot and it's cloudy. So I also depend on the clouds and the weather conditions, and I also depend on the light pollution and how polluted is this area. So basically, if I want to find a spot, I have to search for the place and then see if I have to get to some authorizations, develop a project. That this project has to be a social-oriented project, a conservation-oriented project, and this is how it will work.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. We have also, I think, a follow-up on these questions. It says, how much time does it take to make one composition or photograph?
It depends of what type of picture are you going to get. I have different techniques. I have the single shot. I have the panoramic of single shot. I have a panoramic with HDR, which means different exposures, timing exposures. And I also have the star trails, right? So my basic logic is to get one shot, a single shot, because I also want to follow the ethics of the landscape photography, because there are two type of ethics in this type of images. I have the astrophotography ethics, which means if I have to do an integration of several images, those images has to be taken in the same place, in the same spot, completely follow one by another one in a small period of time. So let's say, for example, if I want to make an integration to reduce noise, it will take me about 5 minutes to get that picture. But what I cannot do is to get a picture during the day, the landscape, and replace the sky. That would be totally unethical. So I follow two type of ethics. The landscape photography ethics, which means a single images, and I also follow the astrophotography ethic, which is the integration of several images to represent the light that was surrounded by the place. So it will depend on what type of picture, but it will take maybe 20 second exposure, 50 second exposure on a really dark sky, because we also depend on the lighting conditions. So that will be a specific. So it could take 5 to 10 minutes.
Okay. So we have another one here. It says that you seem to not be averse to clouds? When do you decide there is too much clouds and stop taking photos?
It will depend on the competition I want, composition I want to make. Sometimes in landscape photography or landscape astrophotography, clouds will help us because we have to consider when we're taking a picture and we are framing how the viewer is going to travel inside the picture. So sometimes those clouds will help us to drive the viewer to some specific point of the picture. So it will depend on the scenario, basically. But sometimes in Guatemala and in tropical countries, what happens is that it's completely cloudy, and maybe there is 1 hour that the sky will completely clear out. So maybe sometimes I spend the whole night waiting for that 1 hour of clear sky. And this is why I take the picture. A lot of pictures that I show you today were taken in small frames of time that I was able to get clear sky. Most of the time was cloudy.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. And what inspired you to combine astrology and photography?
I have to say that there's a difference between astronomy and astrology. Astronomy is a science and astrology is a pseudoscience. And we're not basing our work in pseudoscience. We're basing our work in science. So this is a very important question because the knowledge of the indigenous people of our people maybe sometimes get confused as astrology, but it's not. It is a knowledge. It is a scientific knowledge that was heritage by our ancestors. And this is a very important thing to mention because our indigenous people, they make science, but this is a different science. This is an observational science. They study nature. They study how the patterns of our weather conditions, of storms and stuff. So when you learn about indigenous people worldview, you understand that this is a heritage that has been developed through the years through science, and now it's become a philosophy. And this is how I got inspired, because there's a lot of conservation of nature in their speech, in their philosophy. So when we want to preserve the skies, we also want to preserve the whole nature, right? We want to preserve the animals, the trees, everything. So it's like a global philosophy.
Thank you. And we have a question also regarding this precisely. Someone is asking, which Mayan city is your most favorite to take astrophotographies and why?
I have three favorite cities right now. But I mean, when you get to a dark sky and when you get to a Mayan city, it's going to totally blow your mind. Doesn't matter which city you are, because everything is just amazing. It has different structures, different nature, different stuff. But I do have some favorite. One of my favorite is El Mirador, which is where we find La Danta, the largest pyramid in America. And also we have the darkest skies in Guatemala. So I've been working with this with the archaeological research project in dark sky conservation of Mirador, and I was able to not only watch what my favorite sky because it was totally dark, but also I was able to witness the amount of life that there is in our forest. When we talk about forests, we only talk about trees. But these trees have little birds living in the roots, right? And also there's a lot of animals living in the environment. So this is like my favorite. I also like Tikal because there's nothing like the Central Plaza and being totally dark and just finding the silhouettes of the jaguar and temple too. It's totally amazing. And also Takalikabaj. Maybe Takalikabaj is maybe one of my favorites as well, because Takalikabaj is like the mix of Olmecas and Mayans, and most of the community's worldview we see that in the structure, and it's like totally astronomical. It's a total astronomical city. We also have the small feet altar, which you find a rock with two Mayan feet pointing to the solstice of December, and the sol goes right straight over the feet. So it totally blows my mind. And it's not a huge site because it hasn't had these huge structures, but you know, the landscape, they used to calculate the movement of the sun through the volcanoes because it's in the middle of volcanoes. So they have this mountain star, their markers. They didn't need these huge buildings, right? Like in the lowlands of the Mayans. And this is a very interesting thing about Tikatakalikavak and El Mirador, which are the same epoch, maybe kind of the same epoch. And maybe El Mirador and Takalikavak are the differences, the structures. And archaeologists say is that maybe it's because in Takalikavak there was earthquake, it's an earthquake place, but they also have the volcanoes as markers, astronomical markers. And the difference in the Mirador is that they don't have any markers, so they have to build these huge buildings. And the buildings are also oriented to stars. So it's a very important thing. I think it's, the Mayans developed the most advanced calendars and they were able to calculate eclipses and also Venus, Mars, Saturn, and Jupiter calendars. So there was some kind of tool that they used. We're still looking for those answers, right? But these are archaeological sites. These are like the markers, right? So this is a very important thing, and it's a very important question.
Thank you, Sergio. Actually, it's really interesting what you mentioned. I was actually in Takalikavak during the 2012 solstice, and I could see exactly what you are saying right now. It's something impressive to see. We have another question here that they want to know a little bit about the equipment that you have. What cameras, lenses do you use in order to take these types of pictures?
Okay, it's a great question. I don't have a favorite brand because the cameras that I choose have some characteristics. Like it has to be a full frame. It needs to have a very special low light conditions. It has to be really good to manage low light conditions. I will use wide open lenses or lenses with focal length of 2.8, which is a very important focal length. Right here, I have a Canon 6D Mark II, which is the camera that I'm using for time lapse. But for astrophotography, I use yes. So this is my camera. This is for time lapse, just for time lapse. This is my lens. Is 100mm lens, 2.8, which with this mount I can make a lot of images of the sky without any landscape. But if I also have a Canon 6D, which is modified for astrophotography, this means that they remove the filter and they add another filter that will allow the camera to capture light that we don't see in the infrared of the spectrum. So this capture will let me see a lot of nebula that I cannot see with this camera. So I have two cameras. I use this for time lapse just to help check out how the nature moves. And the other one is for specifically for astrophotography. Okay. And I also have my mount. This mount will help me with the rotation of Earth. So this is going to basically follow the sky.
Okay. Thank you. Here's one that says the pictures, time-lapse videos, and essays are amazing. Congratulations. And how long does it take you to do all of them, especially the time-lapse? And I think that would be the first question.
When it comes to time-lapse, it depends, because when you have a night time-lapse, it might take until 4 hours, from 2 to 4 hours, depending on how much images you want to get. If you want a day time-lapse, it could take 15 minutes to 5 minutes. Most of my time-lapse during day are 5 to 10 minutes. My transitions from day to night are maybe 3 hours, and some of my night time-lapse are from 2 hours to 4 hours of shooting session.
Okay, and then the second question from this person is, how did you engage with the people that you have in the pictures? And they just make a comment.
Oh, that's a very important.
that the work that you do is really important for raising awareness about pollution in urban areas and promote development for a healthy environment.
Yes, in this case, to work with the communities, first of all, it was a great management, and this is another help I had from the Ministry of Culture. I learned about the Mayan Ajiks, so I start talking to them and talking about this great tool that we can use to teach people about this amazing worldview, right? So the first thing we had to do was to, in the worldview of the Mayans, we had to do ceremonies to ask for permission. So we did we have been doing every time we're going to do something, there is a ceremony involved. We also involve communities. We try to teach them different ways of scientific outreach, and this is how it has been done. But to work with the communities, we have to talk to them and also have the authorization in their worldviews, which is amazing.
Okay, thank you. Just for the audience, I know we said that we were going to finish at 7, but because there are so many questions still left, we're going to have just 10 more minutes, so 5 of questions, and then we will wrap up. So following up a question, have you taken pictures during a solstice?
Yes, I made pictures in Atacalikabaj, and I try to capture the sun between the two small feet of the Mayan. I don't have the picture here because I would love to show it to you. But you can follow me on my social media, and this is going. I share some of this images in my social media. I don't know if I can share my website right now, just to people.
I think maybe we can do it right at the end. You can show us your web so people can add it. So how difficult is it for a regular photographer to become an astrophotographer? Do you need to know about astronomy? Do you need special equipment or have specific preparation for this?
This is a great question. My suggestion, because you know, technically speaking, anybody who learns photography can develop this technique. For me, in my personal and professional view, astrophotography is not just about capturing stars. Astrophotography for me is a technique that will allow us to work in low light conditions. So in this perspective, anybody can learn the technique and improve the technique to capture the Milky Way, for example. But in my suggestion is that you learn about astronomy, because that will give you a lot of tools to work with your photography. So it is important for you to know, for example, how the sky moves, how do you measure grades in the sky, how much time will take, where the moon is coming out, what are the stars, what type of stars are you seeing, what type of nebula are we seeing, because this will give you a lot of concepts to work with your photography, not just the Milky Way. There's an environment-dependent photography, which is people are doing just Milky Way shots because that's why they know. So if you learn astronomy, that will give you a lot of tools and a lot of concepts to work with your photography.
Okay, thank you. We will only do 2 more questions. So one would be, do you think it's possible to take similar dazzling photos of the sky from Indonesia?
I don't know about light pollution in Indonesia, but I believe you can do that. You can look for light pollution map. That's the name of the website where I learned. Let's see, light pollution map. .info. That light pollution map, that info. That's going to be the website where I learn, and I'm going to add this to the site so you guys can check for your local area how polluted is your sky, and it will give you tools to look for it around.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. And last question, is there an international organization for astrophotography?
There is not an international organization for astrophotography specifically, there are different groups that are working astrophotography. My suggestion is for you guys to look for TWAN, which is the basically the landscape astrophotographer group. That this is an amazing group of photographers that capture cultural and landmarks in the astrophotography. So the World at Night is a program that also promotes dark sky conservation and heritage conservation, which has been a lot of inspiration for me, the photographers of this group. So I think if you want to learn about an organization, TWAN will be the special one. After that, we have a lot of other institutions like the Astronomy Picture of the Day. Astronomy Picture of the Day is a website which will collect a lot of pictures, astronomical pictures. Maybe this is like a special one. And after that, local clubs, local astronomical clubs. But there are a lot of astrophotography clubs around the world, but those are local.
Okay, thank you. So we're going to wrap it up here with the questions. But Sergio, I don't know if you want to put in the screen your information, like, I don't know, your Instagram, or if you want to have, I think you said you had some Instagram account or something that people can follow you, because maybe if there are more questions or people want to see your photography, they can see it.
Yes, I will share this with you guys in just a bit. My email is Sergio@pinceladasnocturnas.com. If you have any other questions, you can write me anytime. I always answer to your questions. And I also want to share with you, the light pollution map.
I think we're going to put you in on screen now.
Okay. Sharing my screen. This is my Instagram. You guys can follow me on my Instagram. This is kind of an outreach site that I have, my favorite gallery, because there's a lot of people in Instagram nowadays. So I invite you to follow me and also to write me if you have any question. This is my Instagram. And I also want to take this opportunity to share with you that I was nominated for Guatemaltecos Ilustres, which is a site that will promote a lot of Guatemalans, which are, you can look for your favorite, but if you wanna share with me some of your votes, that would be great, because that will definitely give some importance to the projects that we are developing in Guatemala. So if you guys want to vote, you can do it. I appreciate that. But you can also follow me on my site.
Thank you very much, Sergio. So we finally come to the end of the event. It has certainly been incredibly interesting. I think everyone has learned a lot, and a lot of us still continue to have many questions. And we would like to thank everyone that joined us today in this very special celebration for us that, well, we try to do it virtually. We hope that next time we can have you over here, Sergio, either in Indonesia and in Thailand next year. And we hope to see you all in the future. And thank you very much. Have a nice evening.
Thank you.